appealing to their brain, because most of the time there is not much brain. Spiritual is more. Material, yeah, that's another thing. They will have so much brain to develop a new way of sense gratification. There's so much intelligence in them. Oh, they develop things, it's unbelievable. But spiritually spoken, blank out. That's our real problem. We have nobody really much to talk to. In India, it doesn't get much better because they all think, yeah, I know. I know Krishna. I know. What are you talking? I know. My grandfather was chanting. Oh, I know. Oh. But actually, you know, when it comes down to it, what are you doing? I have to upgrade more like the Western. Very modern. You have to become modern. Yeah, so that's actually the real thing. But we should also be satisfied. Look at Prabhupada. Who he could talk to? I just listened yesterday to 2-3 exchanges with Allen Ginsberg. My God, how... what a hush he had. Mm. He was the guru of the hippies, admired by thousands and thousands of hippies. And the man just, he can't even understand what Prabhupada is talking. He just likes spontaneously, emotionally Prabhupada. He was attracted, definitely, and they had a kind of found relationship. Prabhupada gave him lots of credit, knowing that he actually is able to attract people. Prabhupada tells him that tomorrow he will give a lecture. But actually, I think you should speak. And Allen Ginsberg is panicking, you know, like, me speaking in front of you, what shall I say? Prabhupada said, no. You like chanting Hare Krishna?
Yes.
Then tell the hippies how you like chanting Hare Krishna. That's all. And then the next recording actually is, he's doing that. Always adding some bizarre thing, you know, like some weird, you know, stuff. Yeah, chanting Hare Krishna makes you more happy. And when you are more happy, then you can see the universe. You know, Prabhupada didn't bother with it so much. Because he erased the attention. The hippies were going, oh, Allen Ginsberg likes Prabhupada. Oh yeah, and chanting, very good. And then comes a lecture from Prabhupada, completely orthodox lecture. I doubt the audience could really understand much. Straight out, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and up to the point, as in whatever the principles or whatever. Straight out. I don't think the audience really understood much, you know. But they were going, nice. And then Ginsberg was, he chanted Hare Krishna, and they were all singing. The chanting was going for hours, you know. And then that was it. And then they joined. They really joined. Devotees were going, you know, waiting on the door, who's coming next? Shave him up. That's it. The temples were very soon not able to take the impact of people joining. Well, we don't have that problem really so much. Because now everybody is like, yeah. Or simply dragged down to sense gratification, just gross. He knows when I come in here, no more beer. That means not coming. Finish. As if that substance will really save your life. People are so simple and so simply grossly addicted. Sometimes you get almost tempted when you're preaching to say, okay, if you are that gross, I will sell it out really gross. That's a natural impulse you have there, but it doesn't help either, you know. He ended up in Berlin preaching like this, and about devotional eyes. So he's like, before you could even say it, like devotional, I said, you open your mouth too much, you get pneumonia, close it again. Blood. Cut the plug out before the man could even say something. Because there was really nothing to say. There was nothing to you knew it's going to be just. Oh, we have in Berlin, we have lots of fun with this. People coming up, you know. But what? Our GBC was a very special program, and he gave a lecture about, you know, what is right and what is wrong. That's for my advice already a very challenging concept. What? And then there was one woman, she said, what? What did you say? This is right and this is wrong? How can you even say such a thing? How can you say what is right and what is wrong? And he said, well, I'm saying it's in the Shastra. There is no right and wrong. It's all one and the same. And because he's a gleam in his eyes, and soon she said that. He said, oh really? Okay. Okay. It's one and the same. So give me your wallet. She said, why should I do that? It's one and the same. Wallet in your pocket, wallet in my pocket. It's one and the same. And the Germans are so sadistic, you know. They are really, they all get big smile, the whole Sanditis audience, and they're like, give them the wallet, you know. They like the suffering. She started to suffer immediately. And she looked at him and she realized he really needs it. And he got really so agitated, the first thing was just, so she pulled out the wallet with the money. And she said, you know, when you open that inside, she had a little apartment and she had the keys also including from the apartment. So she said, okay, I can give you the wallet, but I keep the keys from the apartment. She was ready to do that. And he said, why? The keys of your apartment, the keys of my apartment, it's all one and the same. So why, what are you talking about, your apartment, my apartment? It's all the same, it's all one. So give me the whole wallet. She almost started to cry. She was completely, and everybody was like, you know. And then she really gave him the wallet. He just took the wallet. He said, I want you to understand only one thing. Do you know how stupid you are? She threw the wallet back on her hand. That was the preaching those days. Such a madness. And people buy it all the time. We are all one and the same, and it's no right and wrong, and it's the same. But they cannot live up to it. If you really live up to it, they'll live up to it. Prabhupada loved that story from Vivekananda when he entered Chicago in the early days of the 20th century, you know, as the first Mayavada powerful preacher entering America, you know. And there is a recording from his diaries, you know, the sermons recorded, the Leela of Vivekananda. He went to a restaurant and he ordered a chicken. And even the waiter in the restaurant was kind of amazed. He said, but sir, you come from India. You eat chicken. You know, Vivekananda said, what is there what I cannot eat? Prabhupada merely commented, they should have bring him a plate with hot stew. Fresh from the toilet. Come on, eat. Prabhupada seems straight to the point. You know? That's at least a story I heard. I never studied life of Vivekananda, so I cannot guarantee it's 100% bona fide, but the idea is there, you know. What is there what I cannot eat? What is there what I cannot do? It's all one and the same. What a suicidal philosophy this is. What a suicidal idea. So Prabhupada also is totally alert. He was so alert that even when his servant shaved his hair, Hare Krishna, he said, Prabhupada, now we put the hair in the room, we wash the floor, and we merge the hair with the Ganga. We saw it in the Ganga, it was in Mayapur. Prabhupada immediately opened his eyes and freshly shaved and said, merging? Never. He objected to the vocabulary. It takes a long time in becoming Krishna conscious to realize how accurate and how real this is even for us. I mean, how we are living in this kind of, we are the product of society which is living on these terms. One and the same, and merging, and this and all this, and maybe we never learn it in a philosophical context, but it's actually practiced in front of our nose every day. And our dealings are full of this kind of stuff. We don't even know it. time we have to perceive the presence of another living entity or something like this. And it's all superficial, it's all floating through the life with such a disconcern. Just living, you know. It's consuming the sense objects day by day. It's scary, it's scary. If you consider once upon a time, you know, living entities, you know, souls in the spiritual world where everybody is, you know, fully aware. Not only about Krishna, but he's also aware of the other ones serving Krishna, and they are all in tune, you know. They are all synchronized under the direction of the internal energy of the Lord. They are all synchronized in his service, in full awareness. And here we are like like wooden logs floating down the river, you know, just bumping into each other sometimes, and sometimes they are disconnected again. And, you know, there was somebody bumping into me. Oh, it was the wife. Okay. You know, like, you know, this completely, you know, external, superficial dealings. It's ghastly diseases. And this was the challenge to come together with Srila Prabhupada. You have to be for real. He forced you to be for real. And the first realization you got, my God, how conditioned I am. Even the most eloquent speaker in the presence of Prabhupada became a full-time idiot. Like Mrs. Ginsberg recording it. Yeah, well, I don't know. I guess LSD is not so good, isn't it? I saw it's not so good. And Prabhupada says, no, it's not good. It's just hallucination. And Allen Ginsberg says, you know, but I'm not smoking. I gave 2 weeks ago, I gave up smoking. He's reporting to Prabhupada like a small child. Prabhupada said, that's very good. But I'm still eating sometimes meat. And then Prabhupada goes, yes, you just live with my disciples. You will stop it automatically. You know, you go, it's amazing, you know. And that man was speaking to thousands of hippies and admiring him, and his pictures were all over the world, and, you know, and Allen Ginsberg is talking about complete concoction stuff. So Srila Prabhupada's words will still gain value the more the conditioned souls are pressed also by material energy and they seek shelter, because the problem with Vedic knowledge is it requires a certain attitude. Western knowledge, academic knowledge, doesn't challenge you. You can have any attitude you want. As long as you academically can repeat what you learned, you are a learned man. That's all. But the Vedic knowledge comes first with attitude. Even a very simple, non-intellectual person in a material sense can get great, you know, vision, a great realization spiritually, and he has the proper attitude. Therefore, spiritual life is first to bow down, wash the pot, and then comes knowledge. That is making it so difficult in the Western world, because we learned exactly opposite. How can I bow down to something I don't know? You inform me, come on. No, the attitude world is stopping it.
I was just thinking about this attitude and approach to wisdom and learning. I distributed books on Prinsessegade outside of Christiania today. And like when groups of young people, they take some books and I know they're going in to smoke hash and get high. Then I tried telling them, so like when you have a fun time, maybe you can take turns in reading out loud to each other. And so, but I was just wondering if this is like if it's good, because like taking dope and then like it's...
Yeah. This is,
but still they get benefit.
Yeah, there's a benefit there, but why to... I would just instruct them in this way, just like, they have the book and they will find out their way. Mm-hmm. And who said? They are the last recipients of that book. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't know where this book's going. Prabhupada wanted a massive book distribution. everywhere, indiscriminately almost. The books are out. Out. And then whatever the books do out there. But you should do it, of course, nicely, and it's very nice when people take a consciously book and they can appreciate that. That's very nice. But the number also is coming to Prabhupada's point of view. Many gods, out. And then the books find their ways. They're out there. People get... That's actually, anyway, the meaning of propaganda, you know. Propaganda means that you just put it out. So that's what they do. You know, you just put a picture everywhere. People go, okay, this is serious now. These pictures are everywhere. That's how shudras work, you know. You just surround them with the image. As one really successful enterprise man said, if I would get any money more, any penny, I spend on advertisement. That was how he became successful. Just put it on the chart and then, and this advertisement, you know, all the time, it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. Be free, Adidas. You know, what free? Shoes? What are those shoes? You know, Prabhupada pointed out an advertisement for cigarettes. Smoke. This is cool. Prabhupada even the word meaning cool. He said, cool? Cigarette is hot. They are cheating. That's simple logic. He didn't actually understand, really, in his innocence, that cool means like an attitude. He said, this is not cool, this is hot. And they say, if you smoke this, you become cool. No, you become hot. It's so much cheating, so much lying. Just images, they provoke emotional images. Well, you know, in our preaching it's not that much different, it's just spiritual. I mean, what do you say all these people do on a street when they're chanting devotees? They just, they respond to they don't understand one thing. We have people attacking you, I have to understand what you are doing. There must be some deeper meaning to this. Instruct me, please. We have people like this. And you say, girl, it's funny people, jealous singing, girl. Maybe once a year you meet somebody like this. But that's okay. That's okay. Kaliyuga is like a superficial place where people just emotion, even devotees sometimes, they're more emotional than they want to admit. I don't want to listen to this. It's just, it doesn't feel so good. I don't feel so good. I like him. He's a nice preacher. He makes me feel so good. That's how we get cheated, you know. When I remember my best well wishes in Krishna consciousness, they didn't felt good at all. They told me things I really didn't want to hear, you know. But something told me inside they were right. Could give you all autobiographical descriptions that I got smashed in Krishna consciousness. So that was really beneficial.
We have to stop anyway.
Okay, it's nice. Maybe if some more of this conducted in the future that you collect points. Why did Prabhupada say that? How did he say that? What does he mean by saying this? There's so much to clarify from this. I don't even call these other letters, you know, how to. There's letters about deity worship, there's letters about so many details, you know, coming up, you know. And that's just the beginning, this is 1970. Then it gets more and more intricate as the movement grew, you know, and Prabhupada was more and more specific, like that. Okay, Jai. Shri Prabhupada, Jai.
Jai!